situation, what do we mean by joint protest duty? I know Pamela mentioned that the joint protest duty has schedule, so I'm not 100% sure that we're 100% on the same page as a committee on, does joint protest duty mean a label? Does it mean a specific amount of time, or does it mean a structure, I think, or schedule is what you said?
Is there something to, and just to play off the council's mind, is there uncertainty? Is that sort of the point? What do you really mean by joint protest?
Let us try to get some clarity on that, particularly with our community on the floor, but I just wonder if there's still some uncertainty of group.
We attempted to get some information from the legislative authors as to what they meant by joint physical custody, and most specifically, was there an intent to imply in that 50-50 custody? And my understanding of the response is no, that is not an implication of physical custody, joint physical custody. You could have joint physical custody with variations of time between parents.
And yet the tie is clear in here that it means substantial parenting time, so I just get the impression that we're supposed to think about how to maximize time with both parents.
I'm sorry, Molly, can you define where you're reading the substantial?
In this letter from Representative Maloney and Saltzman that was provided to us in October, I just want to point out that since we're talking about the current situations that we're trying to capture right now, there is a definition in 518 for joint physical custody. And so that would be the current, as it is today. I mean, that would be the current that we're trying to capture at this phase in the process. So it says joint physical custody means that the routine daily care and control of dozens of a child is structured between the parties.
And that may be, I mean, just to sort of take your point, Molly, that may be something that, as we improve a little bit, we can, maybe there's some recommendations around how that be structured. Maybe we leave it as we understand now. But that can be something we work through. But I appreciate that clarification. What, do you have a second piece to it?
The other issue, I think the current situation that we haven't addressed here is the Constitution. There's a huge body of research that indicates that there is a constitutional right to parent your children, and I don't think we can leave that outside of this conversation.
I think that argument is not argument, but position or notion is something that we should get to. But I'm afraid that if we get to it now, we're going to really sidestep the discussion we're trying to have about what is the current state of the law in Minnesota. And in that regard, if I could just interrupt that notion for a minute, I'd really like to follow up on something that Ms. Wagner said about the current state of the law when she read us the definitions from the statute about what is joint physical custody. And I'd like to direct everyone's attention to a decision that was filed by the Minnesota Court of Appeals on October 14, 2008, which involved a grant by the district court of joint physical custody where the parties didn't agree to it. And I mention that because in that case, which is called Popel, P-O-P-E-L, versus Popel, the district court granted joint physical custody without any presumption existing in our current statute to the parties, despite the fact that the parties did not agree to it, and despite the fact that one of the parents had been convicted of domestic violence during the divorce proceeding, had a drinking problem. And the, there's some very good language in this case about just what Ms. Wagner was talking about. The court's analysis of those four factors that the court must look at if it's considering joint custody. And this is not a published case, but there's a very good analysis about what the court must do if it is considering giving joint physical custody over one party's objection. And what the court must do is analyze each of those four factors that Ms. Wagner mentioned, including the presumption against joint physical custody when domestic violence has occurred. And so I feel like we need to talk about what's happening in our state, what the state of the law is, so that we can eventually start talking about what does it mean to have a presumption of joint physical custody. We know what it means to have a presumption of joint legal custody. And we know that the court doesn't analyze the factors if nobody disagrees. In fact, if parties agree on custody, the court doesn't have to go through the first 13 factors. It trusts parents who are able to reach agreements about their children to make those decisions on their own behalf and on their children's behalf. Because although they're getting divorced, they love their children. And so what would it mean to have a presumption of joint physical custody? Would it be like joint legal custody? And what would happen if one party objected? In the particular case I'm mentioning to you, it was the mother who had physically abused the father and had been convicted of domestic violence in the presence of the children, and she had a drinking problem. And despite that, the trial judge analyzed the factors and granted joint physical custody to the parties. Will it happen in cases? Yes. Even though everybody in this room wouldn't agree to it. But that's not the point. And so I just think we need to start talking about why we're here.